Committee in 2015 can ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices. No apologies have been received. Item one, decision on taking business in private. Committee is invited to agree because in item four in our work programme in private, are you agreed? Item two, as members are aware, the Interception Communications Commissioner released a statement last week confirming that Police Scotland did not seek the judicial approval required when applying for communications data in five cases relating to one investigation. The committee has had an interest in this issue since it first emerged that Police Scotland might have been one of the forces under investigation by the Commissioner, and we agreed to return to the issue once the findings became available. So we've just agreed our work programme in private later at this meeting, and I would suggest we have a detailed discussion, if you wish, on the witnesses that we can have and where we might fit any evidence sessions in on the work programme if we decide to take further action, because we'll have to move things around. But I'm open now to have your general views before we move on.
At the moment, because they seem to be shifted back.
Yes, no, we're not in private. No. Not in private. Yes? Alison.
And you'll know that I wrote to you last week, once this information was published, to ask that the committee do make it a matter of priority that we consider this further. The Commissioner said that he'd uncovered reckless behaviour. I mean, I think it's pretty outrageous, really, that the police force has acted above the law. The protection of a free press is really important in a democracy, and journalist sources are as important as journalists themselves. Yes. So it's clear that there has been significant abuse here. I would urge the committee to think carefully about inviting witnesses. In particular, I would want to hear from the Cabinet Secretary and from senior police officers.
And you know, I responded to that. Yes. And suggested we also have, I think, the SP and somebody involved, the Chief Inspectorate of Police and IOCO, if
yes,
possible, so
indeed.
We got a rounded picture.
I think we need to be absolutely clear who knew what, when and what action was taken.
Margaret. Yeah.
Just to back up what Alison says, I think it's absolutely essential that we have some transparency and accountability on this. So definitely call these people. There shouldn't be any problem with it, even if someone does go to tribunal, because sub judice rules doesn't seem to affect tribunals. So hopefully when we move into private session, we'll just be confirming which witnesses we want to hear from.
And also, obviously, to move our agenda around in the coming weeks, the statutory obligations that we have. I'll take Roddy, then I'll take Elaine. Roddy.
Thank you, Convener. Just briefly, I think it's important to note that from my COCO that said there have been contraventions in respect to five applications, but relating to one investigation. But I do agree this is a matter of public importance. I think it's right the committee should carry out some investigative work in relation to that. But I agree with the convener that any panel of witnesses we might choose to call should be full and round, and not just specifically on the police
cast, as it were. Yeah. Elaine.
Yes, I'd like to agree with other members of the committee that it's very important that we do some work on this. And I also want to particularly concur with your suggestion that the SPA has to present evidence, because we have had concerns in the past that the SPA has not been scrutinising Police Scotland appropriately, and I think it's important that we speak to them.
Are you therefore agreed that we continue? Sorry, John.
Thank you. Well, I'd certainly support everything my colleague said. I think there is an oversight role for this committee, and as Elaine says, that people would anticipate there was a similar role for the police authority. What I'm not clear on is where, and it's not to discuss individuals, were we to ask individuals, do we know, for instance, that there is no criminality associated with any of this, and what would be the implications if we asked people who were, in other circumstances, potentially the accused?
I think that's the issue that we have to resolve in private, whether in fact things move into that area and we find ourselves almost prevented from doing things. That's what I'm saying. An FEI, if there was any hint of criminality, the FEI would come to a halt, because there would be prosecution, there'd be a right of people to silence and so on. Can we leave that? These are important issues that
I just may be allowed one comment.
Yes.
That isn't intended to say I don't think we should do something vigorously.
Oh, no, no, no.
Is rather I don't want to do anything that would trude on another locus.
That's my point. That's why we really need to discuss this fully, so we look at all the issues that are involved in here. But we will be doing something, John. It's the remit and the ambit that we can take in it. Thank you very much. So you're agreeable that we discuss this further in the private session when we look at our agenda as well. Thank you very much. I move on to item three, and this is an evidence session to inform our consideration of the draft budget. Once published, I'll hear from three panels of witnesses, and I would ask the first panel, please, if they would take their positions. It's a bit like Strictly Come Dancing. Could you take your positions, please, on the chairs? You can see what I watch on the telly on a Saturday night. And I'll just suspend for a moment to let the witnesses take their seats. We have three panels before us today, the first on the police budget, the second on the fire and rescue service budget, and the third on the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal budget. And I welcome to our first panel Detective Chief Constable Neil Richardson, Designated Deputy for the Chief Constable, and Janet Murray, Director of Financial Services, Andrew Flanagan, Chair of the SPA, and John Foley, Chief Executive. And I thank you for your written submissions. I'll go straight to questions from members, please. Elaine, followed by Margaret, followed by John.
Thank you, Convener. The SPA is reporting a forecast budget deficit of £25.3 million at the end of this year. Seems to have been a failure to make the savings that were expected. I wondered if you could say a bit more about why that's happened.
And can I say that if you indicate who wishes to speak, I'll call you and your light will come on automatically. Microphones are on. Who wants to take that one up from the SPA? It was a question to the SPA, wasn't
yes,
it?
Or, yes, or indeed to Police Scotland.
Or Police Scotland. Mr Foley.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Yes, indeed, as we forecasted at our last authority meeting, we were forecasting a deficit of £25 million. However, since then, we have engaged collectively from the authority and Police Scotland with a view to reducing that £25 million in an attempt to get to a break-even position by the end of the year. Work is still ongoing to identify such savings. We have identified some, but there is some considerable work required because it is a challenging target.
Yes, DCC Richardson, please.
Well, just, I mean, I agree with that position. I guess from my perspective, I would just want to kind of put a little bit of context around that to say, yes, that's undoubtedly the position as we stand today. But as John said, we're doing a lot of work around trying to reduce that moving forward. The fact that there is a gap, however, was no surprise. We knew that as we went through reform, it was going to become increasingly difficult as we become leaner and as we make the changes and as we have delivered very considerable success over the first nearly 3 years of Police Scotland. It was always going to become more challenging in order to find the savings, whilst at the same time living up to the standards that we set out and complying with the various commitments that we'd made around outsourcing, etc. So whilst, yes, there is a gap there, that's a gap that we did anticipate was likely to be the case, and it has come to pass.
£25.3 million is, as you say, you're trying to identify savings, but £25.3 million is a lot to find by the end of this financial year, particularly since 90% of your costs relate to staff. I mean, is it possible to do this?
Well, again, but that's exactly the work that we're embarked upon. It is difficult, but again, it's set against the overall size of the budget. That is, in fact, a fairly small overspend. Again, we are in the process, as I said, of trying to make look at every area to see where we can make the necessary savings to bring us on budget. But again, my point around this is that set against all of the kind of dynamic arrangements that have been at the heart of the reform, which is, you know, not just the target that we were setting to achieve, but it's also the dynamic change that happens around us in the environment, the need to shift policing needs according to that changing world, as well as with any plan, things always come to light as you go through implementation that weren't apparent from the outset. So again, these are fairly routine areas of kind of change, and the fact that we have got an overspend, as I said, was something that we anticipated was likely to be the case from an early stage.
Can I ask you, are the 17234 police officers set by the former First Minister prior to Police Scotland coming into being, is that a problem? Is that constraining you, the fact that you've got this limit? And
well, I mean, I know there's different views around the police officer number piece. I've spoken about the reform journey on a number of occasions and I've been consistent in my view. Whilst it might be described as restrictions and a difficulty for us, in fact, up until this point, it's been significantly helpful for two primary reasons. One, is that it's enabled us to keep a critical mass of police officers to ensure that service delivery is sustained. And secondly, it's meant that we have provided our entire focus at what is arguably the more challenging areas of reform and the deliverables associated with reform, rather than going straight to officer numbers. And again, the contrast of this is absolutely stark if you look south of the border, where you've seen dramatic reductions in police officer numbers, again, to meet fairly difficult financial requirements. And the fact that chief constables down south are now in regular routine meetings with the public to determine which services will be stopped. We are not in that position in Scotland, largely because we've had stability around that officer number piece. So I wouldn't subscribe to the view that that has been, as you described it, a sort of set of shackles for us.
That certainly wasn't, I think, the view of the former chief constable, who's just retired, Sir Stephen House. I think, if I recall correctly, he did say it was made difficulties for him in that that was one part he could not touch whatsoever, and therefore it didn't give him the flexibility he required. Do you disagree with that view that he had?
No, I'm not suggesting for one second it's been easy. And moving forward, it becomes harder and harder, and I've made that point already in terms of trying to find increasing savings with a limited kind of playground in which to operate in. But the point I've made in terms of has it been a problem or not, what I'm suggesting is it's actually been quite helpful over the initial stages of reform to ensure that the focus was on the more longer term and challenging areas.
But equally, you've also lost a large number of civilian staff. I mean, that's where the cuts have fallen on the civilian staff. Who support police officers, so...
That's correct, but, and again, this was always going to be so. In terms of the transition from eight forces and a national organisation into one, it was always going to be the case that there would be a reduction and a consolidation of numbers.
I'll let Alison, you get supplementary in this, have you? Alison, hello.
Yes, thank you. No, there was a further...
It's good if you respond, you see, when
sorry,
I call your name.
Sorry,
and I know I'm not dreaming here, yes.
This time last year, I asked the Chief Constable if he would tell us if the budget cuts that were expected of him were too much, and he said he would tell us that, but last year he didn't think that was the case. Do you think he should have been more open with us at that time? And can I ask you, looking forward into next year's budget, what are the implications for the forthcoming year?
Well, I mean, I don't want to comment for a previous chief constable. He had his own views around it. Whether or not the savings are challenging, they've always been challenging. We've been clear and consistent about that simple fact. However, we have steadfastly said we would try as far as we possibly could to do that. For the first 2 years, we've done exactly that. There's been substantial change, and to bring us in, and again, I've sort of stressed the fact that we are still working on reducing that gap, and that is our ambition. But I guess the point I'm trying to make is that much of the commentary has been around, you know, failure and around, you know, this is surely a problem. I would take it from a slightly different lens to say this is a mark of success. The fact that we have managed to sustain numbers, the commitments that we've made to communities across Scotland, to ensure that, as far as possible, we do not compromise any particular geography in Scotland in terms of job losses, and all the various things that make up the policing service, and to be in the position, still with some months to run, where we've got a £25 million overspend against a £1 billion budget, I would suggest is quite a significant success story over 3 years. Now, that's not to suggest everything's rosy in the garden. Of course it's not, and there are some very significant challenges still in front of us. But I do think that represents a very considerable kind of successful delivery over a three-year period.
Well, forgive me, but I don't think the staff in the control rooms would consider it a success story, given the pressures that they're facing. And, I mean, what I'm trying to get to, what committee's looking at here today, is the budget that's provided for the police service next year sufficient for you to carry out your resources, carry out your job properly? And we need honest answers about that. We don't need people saying, well, we'll do our very best to try and fit into that. There has to be a point where the police officers tell us actually we can't do all that you're asking us to do with that budget. Have you reached that point yet?
Well no, the simple answer is no. We're in discussion. Okay. We've got the comprehensive spending review, which is in train. We have provided a submission and we're in discussions. And once we know what our budget looks like, I would be in a better position to answer your question. But as we sit here, I would take the view that we are still actively in discussion about that point.
I think Alice is quite right. The point we're trying to make is, you know, it understandably, I'm going to use the word coy, but you're careful just now what you say, but the point about this committee is to ensure that we hold the government to account so that, you know, you're not having to make shift and mend in the Police Scotland, and that what we're doing, our job, scrutinising, you have sufficient funding to do the job that we know you want to do and we would want you to do. So I appreciate if your negotiations have some difficulties, but that's, you know, we need to be told some bad stuff by you, a little bit. It would help you. I'm telling you that. Now, Gil, you put your hand up. As I suspect, everybody's going to go through the same kind of things on cuts and budgets and so on. And I called you and thinking it was going to be about civilian staff. And it was sort of. I'm going to take people on their order because it's all about the same thing. It's all about cuts to the budget and will you have sufficient? So if you'll forgive me, Gil, I've got a list of people who want in who probably are going on the same thing. You're not happy, Bunny.
No, because there's an elephant in the room. I would like to ask.
Well, can I leave the elephant just now?
The elephant in the room is a VAT.
No, Gil, I'm leaving the elephant just now because somebody else might want to raise it. You've got it on the record. You sneaked it under the wire. Margaret to be followed by John, followed by Roderick, followed by Margaret McDougall, followed by Gil and his elephant in the room.
Right,
Margaret, please.
Good morning, panel. In his written submission, HMI Inspector of Constabulary in Scotland says that he doesn't believe the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland have a fully formed financial strategy in place. Obviously, he says he accepts there are unknowns which can prevent such a strategy being completed, including the delay in the current spending review you've already referred to, DCC Richardson. But he said this doesn't prevent the majority of public sector organisations having at least a medium-term financial plan in place. Could you comment on that?
Thank you. Yes, I'm aware of the inspector's comments. We do actually have a financial strategy in place which runs up until the 31st of March 2016. That was the term of it, which was a three-year strategy that was put in place. As we sit at the moment, we are working on the next corporate strategy and finance strategy, and we will have that in place by the end of March so that one strategy runs into the next one.
No, Margaret.
Well, I would like to be reassured that in this interim strategy, certain things that have been highlighted on in the public domain have been taken account of. The overspend on the I-6 project, the increase in costs associated with more training, with various legislative changes in the criminal justice bill, but above all, the concerns that have been raised about the possible developing threats which policing must consider, and this is something else the Inspector of Constabulary has raised, in terms of future investment, both heavily in cyber crime and in counter-terrorism prevention. Could you comment specifically on that? I don't think it's good enough to come to the committee and say, we've got a three-year plan, yeah, we're looking at things. I think we need some details here.
Yes, indeed. The financial strategy which will emerge, and indeed the corporate strategy, will to a large extent be a bottom-up type of strategy. So what we'll be doing is looking into the future to identify all the areas that you've mentioned and others, and we will build it up from that so we have a comprehensive picture which clearly articulates what the corporate strategy is and the finance strategy as we move over the next 3 to 5 years.
That sounds like double Dutch to me. You haven't given me one concrete example. I'd appreciate some concrete examples of what's in these strategies and budgets.
Well, in relation to your specific comments, there will be elements of the strategy which will be involved with training, some of which will be associated with the changes to criminal justice, some of which will be associated with the implementation of things like I-6 and other projects which are on the go. There are a large number of them within Police Scotland. We will be taking account of the requirements to increase capability for cybercrime. So in some ways that would be an investment in people, investment in technology. But we'll be looking across the piece at every aspect of policing to actually build up these strategies. So we will be, the finance strategy, for example, will be supported by strategies in fleet, the states, workforce, amongst other strategies, ICT. So they will all come together to form one corporate strategy.
And what conclusions have you come to? Do you have the resources to deal with these threats?
Well, it's actually ongoing at the moment, but we're going through the process, so we haven't got a final position.
So you've no idea just now if you have the resources or not? Well, is that fair to say?
We have an idea that we have resources to deal with the threats that we know about currently, but clearly as we look into the future, we'll have to prepare ourselves to be able to address threats that will emerge.
I'm aware the Police Federation in particular have raised concerns that they don't feel the rank and file are adequately resourced to cope with terrorist threats.
I'll pass over to Richardson for that part.
Yeah, I'm aware of the Federation comments. I mean, one of the advantages of moving to a national force is to give us greater flexibility to deal with these very issues that we are now confronted with. And so what we're in the process of doing is making necessary adjustments and flexing arrangements to ensure that we do meet that challenge. Prior to the events in Paris, as has been articulated, we had anticipated and planned around a different kind of attack profile. And very clearly what we are now doing is working towards an enhanced profile, and that does involve a change both in terms of capabilities and staff numbers. Now, what we're doing, as I've said, I'm not trying to be evasive around this, we are moving rapidly, and I would want to give some reassurance here that there's nobody hanging out in the wind here. That's not the case. We have got capabilities, but they are being adjusted. And once we have a clarity about any expense or deficit that cannot be accommodated by the kind of flexing that I've described, then we will be in a position to articulate that. But I'm not in a position to articulate the detail of it just now.
That's fine. I want you to tell us the detail of your security movements in public.
As long as it's being considered.
Can I move on now, Margaret?
Yes, certainly.
We've chipped out. John, please, followed by Roderick.
Good morning, panel. I have a question about staff costs. We've had a number of representations, and I suspect that it's just we're using slightly different terminology, but, for instance, ASPS and Unison talk about 92% of staff, the budget being taken up by staff costs. Police Scotland say that around 94% is invested in people-related costs, end quote. And the SP say around 90% in staff budget and staff-related costs made up of 71% police officers and 19% police support staff. Is there a simple way we can say, what is it? I mean, normally with organisation, it is in the 90%, but given the sums that are involved, it would be important to maybe understand what... Yes,
Ms. Murray.
Yep, thank you. yes, in terms of our submission, we do say 94% is police officer and police staff costs, and that also includes as part of that the pensions element that falls within the overall resource budget. So where we quote in terms of employee-related costs, we quote the 94%.
Right, and if I can ask the authority, perhaps Mr. Foley, is it at a different base that... Is it excluding employer costs or something that figure is offered by the police authority?
We take a slightly, it's not a different view, but it's at a different point in time. So if there's a percentage or two different, it's just because it's measured at a different point, that's all.
But we're measuring the same thing because clearly the oversight body and we would want to know
yes.
The oversight body would have the same understanding of the percentage of overall costs that are represented by staff.
Yes, well, as the oversight body, when we report and when we scrutinise figures, it's actually the figures from Police Scotland that we scrutinise and monitor, so it's always those figures that we take.
Right. It came to a different point in time. I don't understand if the difference, 2%, what's that to do with point in time? What does that mean?
It would just be when the authority and perhaps Police Scotland were looking at the ledgers, so when they're closed off. So the figures that we have sometimes can be slightly different, but they're never any more than a percentage or two.
So their figures were later or earlier or something, is what you're telling me?
Police Scotland
different
figures would be later, okay. More up to date.
Right, okay. So it's now 94% then?
Yes, we don't actually have direct access to the numbers in the ledger, so that's why they're slightly different.
Right. Sorry, John.
It's helpful. It's to try and understand, because clearly a single percentage point or two percentage points, when we're talking about that global sum, is a significant sum of money. Mr. Richard, can I regretfully go back to the 1,000 officers a bit? And I stood in a party. It wasn't, of course, the 17,234 isn't the figure. It was 1,000 additional officers that was the manifesto commitments. Can I ask, has there been any discussion at all? I asked the Cabinet Secretary, was there any intention to review that? Has there been any discussion at all about looking at what the intention of that figure was? Because the intention was to provide the effect of 1,000 officers, and with the consummate loss of police support staff, that's not possible to deliver, not least because some of these 1,000 are now replacing. Have you made approaches to the government about perhaps configuring the costs associated with that 1,000 in a different way so that support staff could be retained?
There's been ongoing discussions about a range of things. And I suppose going back to the original intention around reform, it was largely to try and ensure that we had an increased flexibility, as I would describe it, to make sure that communities are appropriately supported. Now, if you look at the objectives of reform and take them as a collective, equal access to specialist function is a good example of where, when the need arises, we would surge forward resource, whatever it looks like, in order to make sure that that community need is met. And so what we've always aimed to do is try and, over time, increase the flexibility more and more. And therefore, the whole kind of issue around numbers becomes quite unhelpful. And it sets in the minds of community members as well that the measure of success is how many police officers are permanently deployed from a particular base or station or whatever it may be. That is difficult when it's directly against the model that we're trying to deliver, which is if there is a need, that need will be met. Some of that need looks like routine presence, but sometimes it looks like a capability that comes in at particular points of the month, of the year, of the week, or whatever it might be. So there is a bit of a contradiction here in relation to numbers, and I would extend that into support staff areas as well, where everybody knows we had a dispersed set of arrangements in Scotland. We had 8 forces, we had national arrangements. There was significant duplication, and that was all enshrined within the business case. And therefore, it was always going to be the case that we would seek to consolidate that. There were some areas that did not previously have police officer presence. But that was not an equal pattern across Scotland. So as part of the changes, there are some areas that we have sought to put more police officers in. And it wasn't, you know, simply so that we could let support staff go. It was a deliberate move to try and make sure that the balance was in line with our kind of experience and judgment and a need for consistency across Scotland.
But if there hadn't been a financial imperative, you wouldn't have dispensed with the services of many. But people understand the issue of duplication 8 times over, 9 times over in many instances. But you wouldn't have dispensed with all of these police support staff had there not been a financial imperative.
I think that that's probably a fair comment, but I would also stress that there would still have been significant consolidation and downsizing. Because if you have various people operating with different practices, approaches, and duplication, that needs to be streamlined to improve efficiency. So again, as part of the original intention and model, it was always the case that there was going to be a slimming down.
A final question, if I may, convener, and it relates to the question you were asked about terrorist threat. Well, certainly what I heard from your colleagues last week was very reassuring. I heard that the known threat had been assessed. There was resilience beyond that which was readily deployed. So I was reassured about that. It's not that we hear from constituents. We hear about routine response and response in relating to, for instance, scenes of crime. Is there sufficient resilience there, Mr. Richardson?
Well, again, this is an area that at the moment we are actively looking, because there is no doubt that things change. And if you take our original model, there have been a number of adjustments that have been made to that model, each in their own right, a substantive requirement in its own right, national units that have come together to deal with particular priorities. But it's very clear, and we are certainly receiving the message from the organisation in various places, that there is significant pressure in some areas. And so we are actively looking at the moment to review where we currently stand, where these pressures are, and what we can realistically do about it. We've had representation made, for example, from the Superintendents Association, and we've commenced a superintendent's review. And that won't just cover superintendent ranks, it also will cover the ranks that lead in to the superintendent ranks to give us a better understanding of the pressures that are articulated by ASPs and whether or not there are meaningful actions that we can put into place quickly to address those. So these are pieces of work that are in train to try and make sure that on an ongoing basis, if there is a pressure that can be addressed, then we will address it.
And can I finally just ask about the PR response to these issues? Because the 10 people who get a very good service, and that is the experience, vast majority experience of a very good public, have a very good experience with the police, they're not in touch with the local paper to share their concern. The one who is told you'll have to wait a few days to get a scenes of crime in your house is. How are Police Scotland dealing with that? Because public competence is affected by all these sort of things.
Yeah, we're acutely aware of that, and it's been incredibly difficult over the last few months. And I don't want to be saying that we're doing a review of absolutely everything, but we are looking at our communications capability just now. We're actively looking to try and increase our presence in the digital area, trying to make sure that that's an area where you can get more coverage and you can target it to make sure that you've got more of a balance of information going to the right places. There are a number of areas that we're actively trying to progress and move forward. It is disappointing to me, if I'm completely honest, that much of the coverage has been very negative, and I'm not saying some of it isn't justified, and of course I am more than happy for the notion of accountability, and I welcome it. But when the kind of coverage is routinely negative and it feels as though it's kind of combative in its nature, it's got an incredibly negative effect on the organisation and the people within it. And again, if you take some of the bare facts, you'll know Cyper created an opportunity to do benchmarking with all European countries that had gone through structural reform. We did some work to detail their experience, and some of those experiences were fairly negative, in the sense that after change, usually complaints go up and performance drops and crime response, etc., is hit. Without exception, the experiences of Europe have not been replicated in Scotland. And in fact, the nearest comparator that we used, I went at a very early stage and then went back with Scottish Government colleagues to Holland to have a look at what they were doing and how they were doing it. They were significantly in front of us. Holland is now, I'm sure if you've read the newspapers, they're in considerable difficulties and they've lost their chief constable, and they're having to revise a number of the plans that they put into place in the first place, and the costs have gone upwards by a considerable margin. So again, against that European and beyond benchmark of experience, what's been delivered in Scotland is not all negative. In fact, there's some very, very strong successes that we are not managing to get into the newspapers and into the public consciousness. And so, yes, I absolutely take the point. We do need to do more to try and ensure that that balanced picture is presented. And we are working on trying to do exactly that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Budget, Roderick, please.
DCC Richardson, when Chief Constable House gave evidence last year, he pointed out that there was an irrecoverable VAT element in the budget of £23 million, which he said could roughly account for 680 officers. What is the irrecoverable figure at the present time?
I'd perhaps ask Janet to give you the detail of that.
The irrecoverable figure is in the region now of about £33 million. Essentially, there's the resource element to the VAT, plus also any VAT that we incur in terms of our capital projects. So that is a significant impact on our overall expenditure levels at this time.
And therefore, presumably, would cover the cost of even more officers than 680.
It would be in the region of over 900 officers.
Okay. In your submission, DCC Richardson, you referred to the overtime budget, £17.5 million, which roughly equates to what was said last year. Could you give us some more information on the challenges to that overtime budget? And we also had evidence last year of a kind of sickness ratio of about 4.2%. What's the current position in relation to sickness as well? So overtime and sickness.
Well, in terms of overtime, yes, that is a kind of ongoing challenge. It is, to some extent at least, a discretionary spend, so it is an area which is legitimate to look at. If we can make savings, we should. Some of the pressures relate to the dynamic nature of policing, and you know, there are some things that you just simply can't plan for, but they need to be met. There are some areas that, for example, particularly in the area of serious crime or the counter-terrorism kind of domain, events emerge and they need to be responded to. And if they're out with the plan or the timescale, even where plans do exist, if the intelligence picture changes, we need to act on that. It's usually overtime that foots that bill. So overtime is not a luxury extra. It's a requirement to enable us to sustain and maintain an appropriate level of provision. In addition to that, some of the initial modelling of the policing resource across Scotland was predicated on a level of overtime. And so it's that blend between permanent posts and an ability, again, following that concept that I described around flexibility, to surge resource in at appropriate times when required. And what I'm trying to describe here is the fact that overtime is not just a luxury extra that can be pruned back. It's an important part to enable us to deliver what we have committed to deliver. We have reduced it by 48% since we went live, and so significant adjustments have been made there in line with the pressures we're under to live within our means. But within that, I would suggest that there is a level which is not discretionary, and please don't push me in terms of picking a level there, because it's not too easy to do. Is there scope to reduce it further? Well, potentially that is the case, and we're in active discussions with the authority about these issues, as you would expect us to be. However, with all of that, it carries a judgment, it carries a level of risk, and we need to look on an ongoing basis, because clearly the dividend of making any adjustments now will be greater than closer to the financial year. And so we will continue to do that. It may be possible to make further kind of savings in that area, but I don't want to compromise officers anywhere around making sure that they deliver what the public expect them to deliver.
Is the in your kind of 23 million kind of overspend at the moment, there is there an element of overtime in that figure? Is the budget, I mean, are you keeping to that budget, or is there an element of overspend at the point?
In terms of the budget at the moment, we are more or less balancing online. It does vary dependent on how an operation proceeds, but at the moment in time, we are remaining to the 17.5 million.
Okay, and the sickness position, present time?
Do you have any figures on sickness? Sorry, I've not actually come prepared with figures on the sickness, but I can easily answer that question by correspondence, yes. If that
okay.
helps.
Okay, and just a small technical one. Last year, we established from Chief Constable House that 329 officers, I think he said, were funded by local authorities in Scotland. Is that position remaining at the present time? There's no indication that that's going to change and put additional pressure on the budget?
Well, these are active conversations, as you would expect, that are taking place just now. If you want my judgment, we are not operating in isolation, and I'm very well aware that local authority colleagues are under the same kind of, if in some areas, even more extreme pressure for reduction. So I'm taking nothing for granted, and we have to just accept that there may be some adjustment there, but I can't confirm that just now.
Cybercrime, different area. What impact is that having in terms of police resourcing?
In terms of people or money?
Well, both, I think.
Yeah. Well, cybercrime is clearly an area that is very, very pressing. It's an area which is undoubtedly a growth industry. It is a major threat, not just for policing, but for the whole of Scotland. We have, in consultation with the authority, made some investment in this particular area, and we have plans to progress that over the next few years to make sure that our capabilities remain fresh and able to meet that threat. But again, when you're dealing with technology, that's a rapidly changing dynamic. So, you know, very quickly, technology, memory space, and all of that kind of thing is superseded. So it is an area which will continue to be a concern for us moving forward. We've had some cyber attacks from a policing point of view, which have been responded to very well. We've managed to you know, effectively manage them in an appropriate fashion. But that's the type of uncertain risk that we face on a day-to-day basis. And that's not just policing, it's any organisation, attacks on their IT systems. So it is important that our infrastructure is properly maintained and modernised to make sure that it's as resilient to these kind of attacks as we can possibly make it. And again, in conjunction with the authority, that is an area of prioritised investment. We have made significant progress there. It is all documented within the corporate strategy, and we are well down the road of delivering what we set out to do in terms of that modernising of the estate. So, I mean, I suppose from a Police Scotland point of view, that I can give you some reassurance is moving well with appropriate investment. From the general kind of cyber crime response, we have an investment and we're in the process of modernising that. We've got a capability just now, but it is at the tail end of its life, so it is important that that investment is progressed.
Okay. And finally, I've got a question for Mr. Flanagan. Mr. Emery, when he gave evidence, your predecessor last year, talked about discussions that he was instigating on the nature of policing in the future, what policing will cost, what skill sets policing needs, and what the balance will be between uniformed and non-uniformed people. And I think he talked at that stage that he'd kicked off with a meeting with academics, Police Scotland and the government. Where are we with those kind of more kind of general discussions?
I think that it comes back to the longer term strategy for policing in Scotland. There are a number of discussions and initiatives going on at the moment. My colleague John would be able to give you more of that detail. But I think Vic had identified correctly that there was a need for a more extensive debate about the nature of policing as we go forward. And in the absence of that debate, it's quite difficult to draw out some of the strategic changes that are required or the budgetary implications of those. And some of your earlier questions in terms of cybercrime are just an example of those kind of changes that are going on. The police can't be isolated from the nature of criminality or the social changes that are going on across society. But I'll pass to John to talk about the detail of that.
Thank you, Chair. When Mr. Emery made those comments, we were at the beginning of a process of looking into a longer-term strategic vision, taking us out to 2026, where we were going to incorporate matters such as demographics, geography, engaging with academics, which we have done. We have engaged actively since that time with CIPER and with some other academics. We've been involved in some reform collaboration work, and we're pulling together a corporate strategy which will be quite cohesive, and as I say, we'll look forward to 2026 and have all of those elements in it. Clearly, we've been engaging along that process with Police Scotland as well, so what we're producing will be a very good product, I would suggest, and that will be available in spring.
Any of this. I mean, I know it's really, it's corporate speak, but I don't really know what it means. I'll be honest, I think if anybody sitting outside was listening, that they don't know what that means, what you've just said. Don't to be rude, I mean, I understand you know what it means, somebody else, it means, I don't know what it means.
Yeah.
So when you say about the nature of policing in corporates, what are we talking about?
Well, I think if I could perhaps be a bit more of a plain speaker then, can
you? Please, yes, I'm a simple woman.
Essentially, what we've done since Mr. Emery made those comments is to pull together what would look like a strategy which understands society as we move forward to 2026. So it would be, in terms of demographics, things like people's age profile, you know, people who are, you know, going into higher education, understanding what their needs are as we move forward, and then reflecting what a police service would be that would satisfy those needs as we move over that time frame.
Right, I've got a little bit further forward there, but I don't understand needs. Yeah. I don't understand what you mean by needs. What do you mean by that? Sorry, if you could just...
Well, I suppose we know that we're projecting forward, we're going to have a more elderly population. So the needs of elderly people in relation to how they engage with a police service would be different from how, for example, a student would engage with a police service. So the use of technology, you know, and what their preferences would be in terms of how you would contact the police, for example, something simple like that. But we would have to put it across the whole range, and we have to predict what the demographics and the geography, etc., looks like over that period.
Roddy, do you want to come back?
I've heard enough at the moment.
I don't know what to make of that. Margaret McDougall, and followed by Christian, please.
Thank you, Convener. Could I just continue on the VAT subject? In hindsight, would it be beneficial to have had exemption from VAT for the Police Scotland?
From my perspective, certainly yes.
We've been consistent in our kind of view around that, and you know, the comments that have been made, I think, set out the position as the only policing organisation in the UK that is paying VAT. It does set us as something of a kind of an outlier, and it is a matter that I think we've been pretty consistent about.
Mm-hmm. So, what discussions are being made, are they ongoing to try and rectify that so that there is exemption?
I think that's really a matter of the government, Margaret, and I think they have been doing it rather than for Police Scotland. It was a matter for the Scottish Government, right, with Westminster. Yep.
Okay, thank you for that. Could I just go back then to the reductions in the number of police support staff, where, you know, there has been talk and there has resulted in backfilling. So what effect has that had on the service, and do you anticipate that there'd be further reductions in support staff?
Well, to clarify again, our position hasn't changed on that. There is no backfilling policy. We are not putting people routinely and systematically into support staff roles in order to fulfil a policy position. That said, I think what has been led previously in this forum was the reality from a day-to-day dynamic around replacing people that go sick or are abstracted for a court purposes or whatever it might be. A judgment is taken, and on occasions police officers will be required to come in and provide temporary cover for positions. It's also been the case that we have had short-term arrangements whereby to enable the flow of people to exit the organisation through voluntary redundancy, if we can speed things up with a position that we know is likely to be concluded in 2 months or 3 months, we have in the past taken a position where a police officer has gone in to enable that member to leave the organisation. But there is no policy around backfilling, and we have no plans to introduce one as we...
policy and just say, is it happening? You know, rather than use the word policy, well, maybe accept there's no policy, but is it happening in practice?
Well, it's an important distinction that...
Yes, it is.
If you want to describe backfilling as police officers fulfilling staff officer functions, then yes, that is happening, but it's not happening on a whole-scale level. It's not happening as a planned approach in order to, as I think the spirit of the question was heading towards, are we seeking to exit as many support staff as possible just with blanket backfill? That's not the case. However, we are living in a world where savings have got to be made, and it would be wrong for me to say there won't be further reductions in staff. What I can't say at the moment is the numbers involved. We are actively working through plans to look at how we can best balance the budget. And again, depending on what the settlement looks like, when that becomes apparent, we'll be in a better position to determine what the size and scale of the organisation needs to be.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I totally understand what you're saying. It's not a policy, but, you know, I think we all know that it does happen, and it's to what extent it actually happens. And, you know, if we were to lose more support staff, well, does that mean that there'll be even more police officers who will have to fill in, you know, in some cases? So I think that is a concern
seeking to do, and this hasn't changed, this has been part of the plan all the way through, is that the initial phase of reform was largely around trying to maintain core services, but to consolidate. And that was the part where it brought the various organisations into a single operating entity. The next stage of that journey is around what might be better understood as the really transformative activity, which involves change of process, it involves doing things differently, it involves being slicker and sharper about the way we do our business. Now, when you're describing sort of loss, it's not happening in isolation, because we are seeking to continually improve the way we are doing our business. There is still lots of bureaucracy in the organisation, and we are systematically trying to reduce that.
Lots of bureaucracy. Tell us about that.
Well, I mean, it's a national organisation that had eight different ways of operating.
Well, forget that bit. We've got rid of the eight different, but just go into what there is left to cull.
But that's the key point. Yes, we don't have eight organisations anymore, but we couldn't change everything overnight. On day one, everything didn't seamlessly go into a common single way of working. What we did was we had a patchwork of process, of policies, of ways of working, of cultures, and we've spent the best part of 3 years working our way through that. You can't do everything overnight. You have to be targeted and planned about what you're doing, and you know, to have a realistic expectation of success, you need to be fairly methodical about that. So that was always going to be a long-term endeavour. But the point is, as we seek to improve efficiency, it releases, or provides the opportunity at least, to release potentially members of staff that no longer are required, because the system is far more efficient. And this is something we have been working through with the unions and the staff associations on. Again, it's a basic principle around reform. It just takes a number of years to work through.
Okay, thanks. Can I just continue? I think
Elaine, you did a supplementary on this same business of civilian staff.
Yeah, really, this is what I was trying to drive at about the 17,234, 1,000 additional police officers, which was determined at a time before Police Scotland existed. It was actually determined at a time when we date forces. Now, if you didn't have that constraint, if you're having police officers working at doing jobs which actually are the jobs of civilian staff who wouldn't be paid the same rate of pay as a police officer, and have a different skill set, because a police officer's skills are not being properly used if they're behind a desk doing the jobs which a skilled civilian member of staff could be doing. Can you get the right sort of balance of workforce when you have that sort of imposition of a number on you?
It's harder to do. I think it's fair to say if you have the constraints. But again, everything, as I've tried to describe, sometimes having those constraints provide a sharper focus in the other areas that need to be progressed. And the reality of this, as I've kind of described, I think through the European examples, there is more complexity than you can possibly imagine associated with a change on this scale. And so to try and simplify things as far as possible is actually quite welcome. It increases your chances of success and delivery. And so I would suggest that the officer numbers piece, as an example, enabled a degree of simplicity in that area to enable the focus to stay where it needed to be. But the reality is we do need to find a balanced workforce. That is not something that you can craft straight away. It's partly the learning experience to determine what does that balance look like, what is the best asset that you need to bring in, and is it support staff or is it a member of a warranted officer? And I suppose as we make the improvements that I've just highlighted in terms of the change process, that changes as well. So the fact that we are now in a position, and again, this will be linked, I'm sure, with the ongoing requirement around savings and the CSR settlement, that will undoubtedly drive another opportunity for us to determine what are we required to deliver, what service do we require to deliver across Scotland, and therefore what is the best mix of staff and police officers to meet it.
You see, I think the question is, if Father Christmas was to bring you a present, would it be that you don't have to stick with 17,234 police officers so you could have some flexibility with the civilian balance? That's the question we're trying to get you to answer, and you've been very careful in your response. We understand why, but if you want this committee to do its job, you have to tell us. So is it a case that having that fixed number of police officers is really an impediment to you having the skill set that you want and the balance that you want? Pretend we're Father Christmas and tell us.
Well, I'm sitting here in front of you as a senior police officer.
I know you
and
are.
And my duty, really, is to get as many police officers as I possibly can.
That's not my question. We agree. We'd love you to have as many police officers on open budget. My direct question is, does that figure, which is what everybody's asked you around this table, prevent you from having the correct skill set? You might want more at some point. You might want fewer. But let's have flexibility.
Well, I absolutely want as much flexibility as I can. I think that the debate is in the wrong place. I think the numbers part is less important than the money part. And I'm more interested in seeing what settlement I can secure and from that determine how best to deliver necessary policing services across Scotland. And again, I come back to the point where I've seen my colleagues down south having very dramatic reductions to police officer
headcount. We understand that. Honestly, DCC, we know all that stuff, so we appreciate that, and we appreciate your caution, but somewhere in there, I think there was an answer, detecting an answer to that question, which we've been pressing. And it's a right one. It's important that we ask it. Yes.
Not finished my question.
No, you're backing up. Just back to police numbers. Is that as finished on that particular link?
Further supplementary on that. Mr. Richardson, you would have us believe that the backfilling is ad hoc and is transient and temporary. If we look at, for example, what's happened with firearms licensing officers, that's not ad hoc. That's a deliberate decision to remove staff, civilian staff, and replace them with police officers on a permanent basis.
Well, I hope it's not a play on words, but it is about a determination of demand and how we best meet that demand. And so that was an area which it was determined that we would do things differently. We would address the demand in a different way. And, you know, it's not a case where you have a member of staff and like for like, you switch them out for a police officer, which is kind of how I would interpret a backfilling kind of question to be.
Well, I think it is semantics then, because I think it is not an ad hoc thing that's happening. It's a quite deliberate thing. And HMICS recognises that in his submission. He says, I notice an increased use of police officers in corporate functions and in other settings with no real business case rationale. And it goes back to what the convener was saying, that you're not able to test the business case rationale for keeping civilian staff in the post because you will not challenge the fact that you have to have this 17.234. Is that not the case?
Well, no, I mean, I understand why you're asking the question and I understand why people would take that view. But in the vast majority of conversations that I can recall around the board table where we're looking at potential ways forward, when we had 8 variations of how different forces did things, there was a real diversity there. And there were some areas that there was no police presence. And some of these are corporate functions. But actually, a corporate function with a knowledge of how it impacts and applies to the policing requirement is actually quite important. And so there was a deliberate move in a number of areas to say we would like to ensure that there is a police knowledge and understanding in that area to make sure that we get a better product, a better delivery, and an informed outcome from that endeavour, whether it's corporate function and there were other areas as well in terms of service delivery, where some forces had moved to a point where there were no police officers at all involved in certain areas of delivery, and we believed as a new national organisation we needed to rebalance that. So there are a number of areas where we have deliberately moved to a position where we now have police officers. It's not a sinister or a Machiavellian kind of plan in order to kind of compromise support staff. It was a deliberate move to try and ensure we delivered the best possible services to the people of Scotland.
I'm going to move on to Christian, please. Oh, Margaret, I thought she indicated. I'm looking after her, you're all right. Christian.
Thank you very much and good morning. Talking about using police officers into functions that they may be not needed. We heard last year about some experience to try, for example, football matches not to be covered anymore with police officers. Have we progressed in this? Have we progressed on events that maybe police officers won't be required?
Well, again, that in that kind of area, the vital, overwhelming imperative is public safety. But that can be met in a number of ways. And the sort of historic way to approach this was to have lots and lots of police officers there. But of course, I think we've moved on in our thinking there. It doesn't need to be a police officer. Security, people can do it. The internal events can hire their own stewards to make sure that the safety of the public is optimised. What we do on every single event that we are asked to support, we will do appropriate planning work, we will do assessments, risk assessments, and we will put forward a view as to how we think that safety can best be managed. And in the majority of occasions, we've seen that has led to fewer police officers, so long as the organisers make sure that they put in the appropriate stewarding. And where we do put police officers in, we have also moved up a policy of ensuring we get cost recovery on that. And again, it's in the best public interest to make sure that the policing budget goes as far as it possibly can.
On cost recovery, I had exchanges of letters with Police Scotland, and it looked like that some political parties, for example, we never recovered the money. And how can we change the tack instead of talking about cost recovery? It's maybe deciding right from the outset what should be covered and what shouldn't be covered by police officers, and have trying to reduce the amount of events covered with police officers. Have we tried to go into that way? Is there any savings? Part of the savings we've seen already have been achieved or not?
But that's what I'm suggesting to you. So in relation to the assessment that's taken, that is done for every event, that is looked at from a lens of making sure that the policing footprint is as small as it can be.
So do we still issue bills to other organisations without knowing if Police Scotland is going to get the money back or not?
Well, we have a policy of cost recovery. And so if somebody goes into default, well, we will pursue that. But ultimately, our stated intention would be to recover cost.
I'm still a bit not. I thought we would have been a lot better ahead compared to last year when we talk about it. Football clubs, have we had a decrease on police officers attending football clubs?
Have you got any of the figures? I'm just checking to see if we've got any information, because that will be available. I didn't bring it with me. I'm not sure if Janet is aware.
Certainly in terms of overall billing to football clubs, we have seen a reduction in some areas in terms of dependent on the game or the nature of the game, or as the DCC has outlined, the actual requirements. But overall figures I don't have with me today, but I can provide that.
It'd be good if you could. Yeah. A second question, and we talked about cybercrime, about terrorism. You talked a lot about coordination with other forces down south and across Europe. And of course, we've got a lot of budget challenges in other forces, budget challenges in Scotland, but across. So do you think the savings we have made are starting to influence that collaboration, are starting to minimise the collaboration that we have with other forces on cybercrime and on the terrorism?
So can I just clarify, you're saying have we improved our collaboration?
No, I just want to know if the collaboration has been affected with the cuts we have in Scotland, down south, and in the rest of Europe.
I think it's fair to say that there is pressure on the collaborations, but in key areas of policing business, we have maintained all the necessary collaborations. So it's true that colleagues, the closest ones, colleagues down south, they themselves have gone through some fairly dramatic change. And so the entire operating arrangements north and south of the border have shifted. So under legacy arrangements, when we had twice as many chief officers as we have now, we would all routinely take responsibility for linking in with our counterparts down south, and we would attend meetings and make sure that flow of information was there. That has moved to a different place because we simply couldn't support that same level of activity now with far fewer people, and the expense of the continued travel and everything else has to be borne in mind. The operating arrangements have provided a more streamlined opportunity with the National Council of Chief Constables, and we are engaged with them, but it's probably fair to say that we are more selective in terms of the groups and the forums in which we actively and more routinely participate in. I don't think that that generates any weakness in any particular area. It's just a kind of more streamlined way of doing business.
So do you think it would be part of the strategy as well to try to make sure that there's no weaknesses in the future with more cuts down south and more cuts in Scotland?
Undoubtedly. I mean, these are active, ongoing discussions. There's a great deal of change that is extremely dynamic. We are involved. I, at a personal level, have been involved in discussions with the Home Office and colleagues, chief officers down south, around these planning arrangements, and they are interested and inviting my view and our experience in Scotland to make sure that that's properly integrated to their emergent decisions. So, I mean, I can offer you a reassurance there. Whilst it's active, they are certainly not ignoring the Scottish need, and we are at the table at the various places that we need to be.
Last question, if you had a Christmas present, would be the amount of VAT that you could recover. You could recover the money, which next year you will not need to talk about cuts?
If you want to give me a Christmas present of the VAT, I will thank you very much for that, yes.
Thank you.
And yes, can I apologise to Gil Patterson about preventing you from asking that. We've since explored it. There's a question that's not been asked, which is of concern from the Police Federation. And I'll quote, whether by accident or design, there are many parts of the service that operate in silos. Each of these silos may well be able to satisfy itself that it's delivering value for money in its own particular area of policing business. But unless we're able to see how they contribute to the totality of policing, it's difficult to genuinely gauge if that contribution is needed or indeed if it could be done without. One of our members recently described the situation as, quotes, those that never existed in the past have created an industry to justify their existence now. That looks like folk creating jobs for themselves and looking busy and not really, nobody can work out what they're doing, what it's costing, there's no monitoring. That seems to me quite an indictment when you're talking about efficiency, streamlining, you know, tightening things up. Here we are. It's a growth industry since Police Scotland came into being.
Okay, if I can answer that in two ways. The first one in relation to that final comment, I suppose my experience is, and I've been to a number of, I've been to seven divisions over the last 2 or 3 weeks, and generally what you find is that things are locally relevant or people are involved from a delivery perspective, their levels of awareness are very high. When you start asking questions about what they perceive to be national requirements, it's not so high. And what I think is probably a fair reflection is that colleagues may very well have that view, and it's not that it's wrong, it's just that they won't have a knowledge of the value that is being delivered from some of the kind of capabilities that I think are being described there. And if we were to sit down and go through all of that, the picture is far less concerning, and it's clearer that it is a collective effort. That said, I think that the criticism is fair. I mentioned to you earlier on that, you know, I tried to breed simplicity in as far as I could. One of the, that started right at the very beginning, where I was responsible for some of the planning for the Police Scotland model, and one of the approaches that I took was to develop effectively silos. It was a group of functions to enable us to make headway and cut through the business. As we've moved forward, these silos have broken down, but I think it's probably a reasonable criticism, because it's coming through from the staff survey and other kind of bits of feedback as well, that there are some areas which again are perhaps not as integrated to the force, or the awareness of their capabilities are not as well known as it should be. I take that that challenge, and as part of the work that we are doing and will do in response to the staff survey, I'm seeking to break that down. So we're actively in conversation, I believe there's a session tonight as well actually, on the follow-up from the staff survey. We're engaging members of staff, and this is the kind of territory we're trying to get into. So what will flow at the turn of the year will be an action plan, and where it's possible to continue to break down these silos and increase the understanding and you know, just the appreciation across the organisation, then we'll do exactly
we
that.
I see the HM Inspector of Constabulary says in its written submission that inspectors reserve, and I quote again, an increased use of police officers in corporate functions and other settings with no real business. It seems to me there's no point having those 17,000 and whatnot police officers if they're sitting talking about stuff and doing strategies and whatnot and everything, but not policing, which it seems to me this is a point that's being made here.
Well, certainly, if anybody's aware of people that are employed in police officer functions and have got nothing to do, then I'm more than happy for
well,
them to bring that to my
with
attention.
No real business is the quote from the Inspector of Constabulary.
I don't know what lies behind that. Certainly not my understanding, but I'm more than happy to act on any information that people want to give me.
Margaret?
Further follow-up points from other members' questions. The VAT exemption doesn't apply to Scotland because there isn't any local funding of taxation. That's why it differs from the rest of the UK. And I think the decision was taken that the savings would outweigh the loss of VAT. That hasn't materialised. Therefore, isn't now time to look at a different structure rather than the centralised funding, which means we can't access the VAT, and also the problems about local taxation. That Christmas present you're talking about for the budget could be realised by looking at that. Is that something we can look at? Should
John,
be looking at.
Yes, indeed. We would like to carefully consider all options. But in relation to VAT, all we can do is to consider options and perhaps make suggestions through government officials. It's not something that we can actually directly affect.
And just on police numbers, I don't think there's any doubt the general public are very supportive of more police in the beat. I think DC Richardson, you've suggested that you'd rather have the money and choose how to spend it. But isn't a big aspect of that money, for example, how it's spent on salaries and some exorbitant salaries that sometimes the public feel cannot be justified? Would you like to comment on that particularly? Because it's an important aspect of looking at the budget in front of us.
Well, I mean, clearly in terms of the money and the distribution of that money, yes, a great big element of that does go in staff, so it's an important component. In terms of salaries across the board, they're all determined through convention and process, and so that's not a matter for me to comment on.
Can I just say thank you very much for your evidence. That concludes this session, and I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes for the next panel of witnesses. Thank you. to just stand. They apparently don't need a break. Panel two, I welcome our second panel of witnesses to the meeting. And we have Sarah O'Donnell, who is Director of Finance and Contractual Services, Pat Waters, Chair of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service Board, and Alasdair, Chief Officer, Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And I know you were sitting through the previous session as well. And I thank you for your written submissions. And I'll go straight to questions from members. And Elaine's first off the starting block, followed by John, followed by Roddy. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. You say in your written submission that you could manage a flat budget settlement, but that a cash reduction would be extremely challenging. There hasn't been the equivalent of the 17,234 in the fire service. There's not a set number of firefighters or which you can't drop below. Has that been of assistance to the SFRS in terms of managing your budget, that you've had additional flexibility?
Chief Hay, please.
Do I have to press the button?
No, it comes on. It should do. We have system all go. Yes, thank you.
In simple terms, that flexibility has been an assistance to us. The way that the eight legacy services crewed the frontline appliances varied. Every service had a different approach to it. We have put the safety of communities and the safety of firefighters at the forefront of our thinking and every change that we've actually made. We have agreed a resource-based crew model with the Fire Brigades Union, which requires us to have 3,709 firefighters. At this moment in time, we are 54 above that, although they're not all in the right place across Scotland. And we're using overtime, you know, to smooth out that curve to get people into the right places. We've got a recruitment campaign that will be kicking off for the north of Scotland early in the new year, and we're actually going to recruit 33 additional whole-time firefighters in January of this year, so that we get to that sustainable model. But if we hadn't had the flexibility, if we'd had a fixed number, we believe it would have been more difficult. But if you also look in our submission, it points out that although 79% of our budget goes on staff costs, only 58% of the savings that we've achieved have actually come from reductions in staff. So we appreciate staff and what make the difference, and we appreciate that community safety and firefighter safety are priorities for us, but flexibility has been essential in our opinion.
Do you agree with the Fire Brigade Union, however, that no further reduction in frontline staff is possible? Is that part of the challenge that you would face if you had a reducing budget?
It is our frontline staff that ultimately deliver the improvement in safety outcomes for the people of Scotland. We would also say that there is real opportunities for the Fire and Rescue Service to contribute to the health and social care reform agenda to improve outcomes for the people of Scotland, and I think we're all responding to the new risks that the country actually faces at this moment in time. So I would urge caution in any changes to the Fire and Rescue Service at this moment in time. We have to realise the future potential. We have to understand what the risks actually are, and they are changing. And we have to consolidate the real gains in efficiency and effectiveness that we have achieved through the reform process.
But do you agree with the FBU that basically the savings are exhausted now? You've done as much as you can in terms of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and you've saved as much as possible.
Well, we've been set a target of £328 million through the reform process. We're on track to deliver that. If we were to go beyond the target that was set for us, it would mean that we'd have to re-examine our delivery model. Mm-hmm. And at this moment in time, my recommendation would be to consolidate it, to look at how we can add additional value in other ways, and to understand what the change and risk is to the country and the contribution that the Fire and Rescue Service would make to that.
Thank you.
There must be pressures on your resources too with terrorism, as much as there is with the police. Are you the capabilities to deal with this in terms of your budget and your manpower and women power?
Yeah. Of course, our heart goes out to the people of France, particularly in Paris, following the very recent coordinated terrorist attacks that we all witnessed. I think you will see, if you watch footage from that, that our colleagues in the Sapeurs Pompiers in Paris are absolutely in the front line of this.
Yes.
If you remember, there was 343 firefighters were actually killed in the Twin Towers attack in 9/11. Firefighters are absolutely in the front line of any response to this. We have an ask of us in terms of our preparedness. We are prepared to meet that ask. However, similar to our colleagues in police, this is not a static risk. It is changing. The terrorists continually modify how they may rain terror upon cities, and we have to prepare and we have to change all the time to meet any potential threat to the country.
Is there an opportunity for you to have additional resources, if required, from the government, rather than just what you have here, you know, if these additional demands were put upon your frontline services?
Yeah. It would be difficult for me at this moment to actually quantify, but having observed and had an initial consideration of the way terrorism is emerging, we can definitely see areas where additional resources coming to the Fire and Rescue Service would be usefully deployed.
Thanks for that. John?
Thank you very much indeed. Can I ask about the retained service, Mr. Hay, and the challenges with that? We've gone into this in the past, as social patterns, people's work patterns, lifestyles and the rest. That remains a challenge, and not one simply of budget, presumably, or not?
It remains a challenge. I'm happy to report back to the Justice Committee that we, as was stated, we've initiated two major pieces of work. One was to consolidate and harmonise the processes from the eight legacy services. That is coming to an end, and we've got some efficiencies in there in terms of the period of time between people initially being attracted to the fire service, going through all the necessary selection processes and actually taking up their employment, things like that. We've harmonised, we've streamlined that, and we've got some really positive feedback in relation to that. But the second part of the project we're doing, which is to ask the question, if we were to redesign a retained service for the 21st century, what would it look like? Because it was designed in the 1950s, when lifestyles, as we've discussed before, were completely different. We've got three significant pilots running, one in Aberdeenshire, one in Scottish Borders, and one in East Lothian, to learn lessons from that. But fundamentally, we think it needs a complete redesign, and it has to be looked at not as a separate part or an adjunct to the Fire and Rescue Service. It is a core part of it, and it has to be redesigned in conjunction with a redesign of the whole of the Fire and Rescue Service to answer that question. And we'll be bringing forward recommendations to our board early in the new year that presents him with a series of options as to how we might be able to achieve that.
If I can be parochial, because I know how the convener likes me being parochial, the example of the excellent training facilities you put in the islands, is that an example of spend to save? Because there will be the added bonus of being able to recruit people who might otherwise have had to go in for a considerable period.
Having listened to some of the barriers that exist to people either joining or remaining within the Fire and Rescue Service, the fact that in some of the rural parts of the country they were having to travel to centralised points, taking 3 days out from their work, 3 days out from their families, it was a significant barrier. So we're in the process of putting significant training facilities across Scotland so that firefighters can actually access these things locally. And it is a spend to save, because there are significant costs involved in bringing from the islands firefighters to the mainland in terms of travel, in terms of accommodation, in terms of subsistence. So we've done a business case, so financially it stacks up, but also the indirect costs by losing committed staff because they just can't meet the commitments, that all stacks up as well.
And are there other examples of elsewhere in the country where that approach has been adopted, or will that come from your your three pilots that you're looking at?
In terms of the training, we have got a significant training need and a significant training infrastructure in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. There are 46 generic risks that firefighters may be expected to attend. What we have done is we've mapped out all the training facilities across Scotland, and based on the risks within a locality, so what are firefighters likely to attend, within our capital investment programme, what we intend to do is make sure that they've got adequate training facilities to meet the risks in their area within a reasonable travel time. Notionally, we've put that at about 1 hour. So the training facilities you witnessed us opening last week in Stornoway, were investing in similar training facilities in the Shetlands, in Orkney, and also in other parts of the north of Scotland, because these are our more remote and rural areas.
Okay, thank you very much indeed.
I'll not be parochial and ask about the Scottish borders, though I'm itching to do so. I won't do it. Roderick, please.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, panel. The £7 million worth of recurring cash savings which have yet to be found by 2019-20. Am I right in considering that this is mostly from control room rationalisation and resource-based crewing model? How is that £7 million put together, and how are you approaching managing change in relation to the control rooms, bearing in mind the experience of the police control rooms?
If I can open on the first part to that, and then allow Sarah to come in, and then I'll deal with the control room question separately. We have the ask in terms of the savings that are expected of us through the financial memorandum that supported the Police and Fire Reform Act, £328 million. Taking us up to 1920, we created a critical savings pathway. That critical savings pathway identified four main areas. It was a reduction in staff and the associated costs that go along with that. But it was also about a property and contract rationalisation. It was also about streamlining processes and also looking at additional shared services. And over that timeline, taking us up to 1920 on that critical savings pathway, we have actually identified specific initiatives, specific projects, and we've quantified how much we expect to save from each of these projects along that critical savings pathway. And that is our medium-term financial strategy for the organisation. If you want some of the specifics around those headline areas, I'm sure Sarah could identify these to you.
Yeah, okay. In addition to the resource-based crewing model and the control room rationalisation, we also have savings accruing in relation to what we described as our property strategic intent. So we went through a process of reviewing our corporate buildings and identifying where we could create an infrastructure that was fit for purpose for Scotland. So there's a number of savings due to come through in relation to that, and also further asset and contract rationalisation. And also savings still accruing from the implementation of our HR payroll system, which is a single system across Scotland. And all of that enables us to improve our processes and save money on multiple contracts.
Okay. Control rooms?
Clearly, we have a programme of rationalisation with our control rooms. We are coming down from 8 control rooms to 3 large regional control rooms. As I've given evidence before, we've modelled this on the Johnston control room, which covered 12 local authority areas. It covered roughly half the population of Scotland, and ranged from remote island communities through Scotland's largest conurbation all the way down now to the Scottish borders. So we're modelling it on a model that we know works and we know is safe. We have got clear leadership on this. We've put in appropriate governance arrangements, including having an effective programme and individual project management to make sure that we do this safely. We've engaged closely with staff in relation to this, specifically our control room staff. We have an expertise in these areas. And to date, we have merged the Dumfries control into the Johnston control. Only last week, we've got the new control room in Toll Cross up and running, and our Edinburgh staff have moved into that, and we're in the process of migrating staff, firstly from Marriston and secondly from Thornton into that. And by this time next year, it would be our intention to do the third part, which would be to bring Inverness and Aberdeen into the Dundee control room. Clearly, we have read with a lot of interest the reports in relation to the police control rooms. I've had a verbal assurance from the Assistant Chief Officer, who is responsible for this project, that he has reflected fully on the findings in there, and this week I will get a full written report from him, and if there are any lessons to improve what has to be a safe and secure transition, we will absolutely assure this committee that we will learn them.
And so far, in terms of the reorganisation that's taken place to date, have there been any teething problems that you would like to share with us? Or
there have been no teething problems that have caused us any significant issues. The way we've tried to do it is we've had the new control rooms up and running, as we have with Edinburgh, whilst the other control rooms are still operating, but we're shadowing the operations that go in there to make sure that everything is fully functional, making sure the staff are supported in terms of the training that they require to operate within the new control rooms before we actually move them in and go live.
Final question, just in terms of, you talked about a recruitment campaign in the north. Other evidence we've seen have talked about recruitment freezes. Could you just clarify when there's been a freeze and how recent the recruitment campaign has been?
Yeah, I'm not sure we've ever spoken about a freeze. We have been reducing the number of whole-time firefighters. We've been actively and continually recruiting into our retained stations across the country. Initially, in terms of the whole-time, what we did is we offered up 40 whole-time firefighters posts to support staff, because what we wanted to give them assurance of is when we said there would be opportunities perhaps to retrain within the service, as well as offering voluntary servants and early retirement, plus people and moving into the same role, but within a different location within the service. We wanted to give reassurances that our promises of retraining were realistic and they were tangible. So the first thing we did was offer up 40 whole-time firefighters posts, and support staff moved into those. We then did a public national recruitment campaign, and we took on just under 40 people. I think we intended 40, but at the end, some people failed medicals, etc. And we've got, we had 39 people on a holding list, and when we went back to them, we've got 33 of those that are going to come back and start with us in January. We've got some specific issues in the north of Scotland, predominantly the northeast of Scotland, if I'm being honest, where we have had to compete, as the whole of the public sector has, with the challenges of the oil industry.
Thank you.
I've got Margaret McDougall, please.
Thank you. The Fire Brigade Union has suggested there is a worrying trend of increasing response times. Do you have a particular concern about the services in this area?
Having read the Fire Brigade Union submission, and to be fair, they have shared these concerns with me previously. This is something that across the UK has been looked at. There is a slight increase in the response times, but a lot of the evidence for that would show that it's because of changing traffic patterns across the UK. So this has really happened at a UK level. Within Scotland, we have no evidence of specific increases in response times. In terms of response times, I think what you also have to think about is that the time between a fire actually starting and the time somebody discovering that it has started. And one of the biggest things that we have focused on is prevention activities. We have delivered You know, since the inception of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, close to 250,000 home fire safety visits, and we've installed in many of these premises smoke detectors. So in terms of that response time, you have to look at the whole response window. It's not just the travel time from alert to arriving at the incident. One of the most significant parts is the time from ignition to alert. And we believe that if you look at that whole window, the programme of prevention we've put in, but also early detection, is making the people of Scotland significantly safer. And we would evidence that. We would evidence that by, in the first 2 years of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, it was the two lowest years ever for fire deaths in Scotland. And we are not complacent in any way in relation to that. But when you talk about response times, you have to look at that whole window.
Thanks for that. But is there a target for response times? I mean, are we talking about reducing that, or is that unfounded, that view?
We don't set a target for response times within the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Previously, the whole of the UK Fire Service was predicated on response times. A risk, B risk, C risk, D risk, and remote rural. For A risk, which is the centre of our big cities, it was to have two fire appliances within 5 minutes and a third within eight, and then slowly it went down to remote rural where there was no defined time. That was changed in about 10 years ago, 2005, where we introduced integrated risk management planning, where what you have to do first and foremost is identify what the risks actually are, quantify that, and then take measures to reduce that risk, and then have sufficient emergency response to be able to deal with the remaining risk if and when it manifests itself as an actual incident. So the approach changed significantly with a much greater emphasis upon the prevention side of it. And having that greater focus on the prevention side, looking at this as a whole system instead of isolating individual parts such as response times, has contributed significantly to the reduction in the number of incidents that occur, not just here in Scotland, but across the UK.
Thank you.
Gil, please, followed by Christian.
It's a follow-up to John Finney's question in relation to training. And I wonder if you could tell us about training for your rescue service. My experience in the motor trade and accident damage, and the professionalism and the ongoing training that's needed for that. There's a highly, highly skilled people that are involved in that, but they need continual training. I wonder if you're able to provide that, or if the budget constraints that you're working under has had any impact on that.
We, as I said earlier, there's 46 generic risk types that we prepare our firefighters to respond to. A significant one within that is responding to road traffic collisions. We have a significant investment in equipment, the tools that firefighters require to actually rescue people from collisions between vehicles. But the tools are no use without skilled operators. So we have a continual programme of maintaining the skills that firefighters have. And we also, at our central training establishments, we have road traffic collision instructors courses so that these people are continually getting the latest input, and they can cascade that out throughout the organisation. In terms of budget constraints, we do not wish to compromise at all in terms of training. Firefighters work in an inherently dangerous environment, not just at road traffic collisions, and we have consciously protected the budgets around training and the training time within the organisation. So any cut in our budget, these are the types of areas where we would try to protect, and it would be an extremely difficult decision for us to make to reduce the amount of training that firefighters actually receive.
Yes.
In certain industries, probably in most industries, training would be seen as a soft option, something that in times of financial constraint, they would look to issue cuts in training. because the fire and rescue service has been so successful in its prevention mode, not just since in the last 3 years, but this is in the past 10 years, it's been extremely successful in that protection. Our crews need more training and no less as a result of that. If our crews are unsafe when they get to an incident, your constituents are unsafe when they arrive. And that is not something that we can throw. So it is not a soft option in the fire and rescue service, but an extremely hard area that we want to maintain and improve.
Appreciate the comments. And while Pat Waters is on the floor at the present time, I think it would be madness for a committee like this, where we're actually talking about the budget, not to bring up VAT and the impact that it's got on it. If we don't mention it, how are we going to send the message that something has got to give here in relation to that? So I wonder if you could make any comment on that, Mr. Waters.
I mean, the whole situation in VAT, as you heard previously, the police, they're the only police service in the country. We are the only fire service in the country that has to pay a value-added tax to provide in emergency services to communities within Scotland. As a matter of fact, if you think about it, for every pound one of your constituents pays, we provide them with 80 pence of service. If that was happening in Tesco's or Morrison's or in Marks and Spencer's, there would be an outcry about it. It is not right, it is not fair, and we should do something about it. We should be providing a full pound of service to our communities, not a 20% reduction in that.
Thanks for that.
It's
on the record.
Just a point of clarification, because we've discussed this with the Scottish Police Authority as well. I understand that the Scottish Police Authority received some funding from the police reform allocation in order to assist with the VAT bill. Has the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service had the same sort of treatment?
No.
Do you know, have you had any explanation? You've had to find that all yourselves with no reform allocation?
Yes.
Christian, please.
In terms of pressure of recruitment, I just wanted to know where we were on the ageing of the service personnel. Have we managed to having a younger firefighters? So are we still have a problem on that particular thing? And the second thing would be on recruitment. You say you've got pilots in the North East, for example, and I hope that the downturn on the oil and gas will maybe help you there. What about gender balance? Are we progressing in the right direction on that as well?
Yeah. In relation to the ageing profile of the Fire and Rescue Service, I think the Fire Brigade Union make that comment in relation to changes to the pension schemes and the fact that firefighters will have to work longer, and they question whether firefighters are able to maintain the fitness levels to do what is a physically demanding job as they progress through their 50s, perhaps into their 60s. So that's where they express the concerns around an ageing workforce. It's not really specifically got anything to do with the recruitment. When people that are as old as me joined the fire service, you had to be under 30 to join the service. But clearly there is age discrimination issues in relation to that, and those regulations were removed. So it is now for people from 18, you know, to any age where they can demonstrate the competence who's required to be a firefighter to join, and our processes encourage people from the full spectrum of ages. But our processes are also, we use positive action initiatives to try and encourage people to apply from underrepresented groups. But because we are not recruiting in any great numbers, we're not seeing any significant change in the profile. Only 4% of our operational workforce are actually women at this moment in time. And when you're recruiting low numbers, you're not going to see in the short term any significant change in that profile. But that's not because the Fire and Rescue Service is not committed to giving everybody a fair and open opportunity to join the Fire and Rescue Service. You know, we're using all the best practice recruitment techniques so that as new people come in, that profile we hope will change. But we would also suggest that changing the offer of the fire and rescue service, and there are great opportunities for us to make a bigger contribution to the health and social care agenda. Professor Sir Lewis Ritchie published a report yesterday, which was commissioned by the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport, looking at primary care out of hours cover. And within that, he comments, one of his recommendations is for a more significant contribution, both in terms of emergency response, but particularly in terms of the prevention aspect, that there's a role for the Fire and Rescue Service there. And changing that type of offer of what the Fire and Rescue Service is all about will clearly appeal to a greater diversity of people. And we believe this is another invest to save. If you look at the evidence from Manchester, every pound that the Fire and Rescue Service is spending in this particular area, they are getting at least £4 back in terms of public value, taking money out of the system. So it's a complex issue, recruitment, ageing workforces, but it cuts across a lot of the areas that we are looking at now and in terms of potential for the future about what the Fire and Rescue Service does to improve the lives of people in Scotland.
Would you consider some share budget maybe with the health and care and with the Police Scotland as well in the future?
We're already actively in discussions. I mean, we believe fundamentally that we work for the public, and we work for the public, yes, through the Fire and Rescue Service, but through a wider public service. And we have commitments, you know, through community planning and other areas where we sit down and look at how the collective resource that we, you know, use on behalf of the public can be spent to best effect. So we are always open to that type of discussion, and we're actively involved in them at this moment in time.
Do you think that would help as well as the recruitment? Because you seem to have a problem with a lot of pressure, and you spend a lot of money of your budget on recruitment and trying to recruit the people and the right people. Having a different role for firefighters will maybe help that as well on the same time.
If you have a diversity of career opportunities within any organisation, you're going to appeal to a wider group of people. And if people within a service get opportunities to grow within their roles and move into other areas, that clearly helps with the retention of staff.
I'm still a bit worried about this this pressure on recruitment. If tomorrow you get all the VAT that you are due, you will be able to recruit 350 firefighters, we heard last year. But you won't be able to recruit 355 fighters because the pressure on recruitment is so difficult that you would struggle to recruit 100.
We could easily recruit 350 firefighters if we had that VAT money, because that's whole-time firefighters. We do not struggle in any way, shape or form to attract whole-time firefighters. The last time I had figures for it, we had 54 applicants for every single vacancy that we have within the whole-time, and I would suggest that number will have increased. Where we have difficulties is within the retained service in remote rural areas.
It's good to hear about 355 fighters extra. You can do manage it if needs to be. Thank you.
Thank you for your evidence, Christian. Can I have Alison, please?
Convener. I've got two different areas I want to question on. Could I first of all go back to the vacancies in the northeast? It's certainly reported locally that the staffing is so short that it's the equivalent of one appliance down. Can I ask you to comment on that, and perhaps for the board to tell me when they were first alerted to the scale of the staff shortages in the North East?
We have more firefighters in Scotland than we need for the model, that 3,709 that we're moving towards. We are absolutely supportive of the no compulsory redundancies. We would not have achieved the success that we have in terms of the reform without the considerable support of the representative bodies, but particularly of individual staff members within the organisation. That means that within a budget, you have to pay all the staff you have, and if you have shorties in given geographic areas, then it is difficult to actually find the resource to pay for that. So we've got a balancing act going on there. The number of people that have exited the service in the northeast has been greater than other parts of the country because the economy has been so buoyant, and you would hear the same from, I'm sure, from health, from local government, from everybody who seeks to employ staff within that area. What we've been doing is making use of two things. First of all, when we did the recruitment campaign for the National Service, we specifically highlighted that the predominance of vacancies would be in the north of Scotland. So even though people may live in Glasgow, Edinburgh, it was clear that that's where we'd be recruiting them, and they were joining on that basis. And many people relocated up there to join the Fire and Rescue Service. And what we've also done is we've made a judicious use of overtime, you know, to make sure that we can keep the appliances, as many appliances as possible, available. So we've been doing those two things, but we're at the point where we consider that would not be an economic use of overtime within the northeast of Scotland, and we're going to do a very specific targeted recruitment campaign for that particular part of the country.
So that means you've been relying very heavily on overtime in the interim, and actually perhaps putting a lot of pressure on staff?
Well, I would describe it as having a structural deficit in the organisation. We have enough people, but they're not necessarily in the right place. Yeah. So, you know, over the long term, you know, viewing it for 4 to 5 years, we will get that structure right. We're 3 years into this, and the use of overtime to smooth out that demand curve, I think, is a judicious use of resources within the service. It is voluntary. Overtime. We've operated in the past. Fire Brigades Union maintained a 25-year overtime ban, so we've operated with overtime and without overtime in the past. It is voluntary, and we do not seek to put too much pressure on staff. Many staff members welcome the opportunity, particularly with the high house prices and other cost pressures in the northeast, the opportunity to take on some overtime. But I do accept that there is a balance, and that is why at this point in time we've made the conscious decision that we need to do some very specific targeted recruiting for the northeast of Scotland.
Can I say, Alison, that the board has been acutely conscious of the situation in the northeast of Scotland and the problems that we face in the northeast of Scotland. As a matter of fact, we have advertised on 6 occasions now for mechanics to cover our repair base in Aberdeen without success in any of those occasions. So the board has been acutely aware of it. Can I maybe just add to the point that the chief officer was making? And I think part of the problem that we've had is that we had staff who were given protection about where they worked at the time of transfer. So therefore we couldn't transfer people out with their original area where they worked. We have very recently come to an agreement with the FP Trade Union that within a reasonable area we can transfer, which will ease the problem elsewhere, and we can maybe see, you know, a knock-on effect going up the country. But I mean, I think that was a major give from the trade unions, and we appreciate their cooperation very, very much.
I think that update's helpful, because I understand the situation has become acute and there are concerns in the northeast. So I'm grateful for the detail that you've given this afternoon. Can I turn to the assurances that we had during the reform legislation, when the government said it would be for the Fire and Rescue Service to determine where its headquarters were? And we'll know that last week there was an announcement that the headquarters are not going to be where your first choice was. Can you tell us some more about the process and when the government first asked you to think again about that, and whether there have been any abortive costs of changing tack in the middle here?
Can I maybe come in first and then the chief officer come in? I mean, certainly when we looked at where the headquarters was going to be, we were very clear about what we were looking for. We were looking for somewhere within a triangle that was taken in the centre of Scotland. We were looking at in Perth and Stirling and in Falkirk and the areas mm-hmm. surrounding that. It was very clear that that was ideal for us. When we looked at the facilities already there, we didn't, as a service, have anything suitable that we could have moved into without major impact on spend into revamp an older building or an existing a fire station. When we looked at other government properties within there was nothing there, and we even looked at sharing in Stirling with the police, and that was not an option for us either. So we opted for a new build, and we put forward a project that was there. I think that came at the exact same time as the government in Westminster announced a continuation of the tightening of expenditure, and given that we had been spending something like 11 million, I think it was, Sarah. Yeah. 11 million on a new build property, the government asked us to look again, and they relaxed one of the areas that they say is that we shouldn't use any existing headquarters premises, and they relaxed that, and we could understand why that was asked at the first point. When we done the next exercise, we then looked at the facility we have at Cambus Lang, and it's a first-class facility that we have in Cambus Lang. And so there, if it was an option, we could move into an existing building without any major alteration to it whatsoever. The matter of fact, there would be very little money spent for us to establish that headquarters in the first place, and it seemed a really good option. And also, it gave us, freed up some of our capital money that we could use for other necessary projects that we wanted to see developed as a priority ongoing. But I'll maybe hand off to the Chief Officer if there's anything else he wants to add.
I think Pat's given a very comprehensive answer there. Maybe just to remind everybody that within the Act, it always said that final approval had to be given by the Minister in relation to that. Our colleagues within Scottish Government, within the sponsor department, worked with us to set the initial criteria to meet ministerial aspirations. But as Pat's just described, during the process, then the operating environment in which we all exist does move on. So some decisions and thinking that was established, 3 years ago, in the light of where we are today, sometimes you have to say actually a more sensible use of public money would be to not spend it in that way, but to use it another way. And we fully accept that decision. I think lying behind it was the real desire to make sure that as a national service, we did not operate in a centralised fashion. That what we did is we used the benefits of a major organisation to offer people not just services but also potential employment opportunities across the whole of Scotland. So when we look at our model that we are setting up, we absolutely want to operate in a decentralised way where people at the lowest possible level feel empowered to make the right decisions to improve outcomes. And if you break that down into hard numbers, we've got 356 fire stations across Scotland. When we've created our enabling infrastructure in terms of the control rooms, in terms of the workshops, in terms of headquarters, and also in terms of service delivery headquarters, we've tried to create a footprint as best we possibly can across the whole of the country. And only 2% of our staff will actually work within the headquarters. It's around 73% of our staff working in the fire stations, which leaves about 25% of our staff working in all these other locations. So yes, there has been a change. I think it was understandable, but in terms of the desire to create a decentralised organisation, when you break down the work locations, which give people opportunity, perhaps in the future, to gain employment with us, we are very much sticking to that principle.
And my question about abortive costs, I mean, in developing the new build proposal, the £11 million project, what has been spent on working up that proposal?
Yeah, we don't have the exact figures to hand today, but we can certainly supply that to you. Yes. What I would say, though, is The work that was done in relation to looking at possible options for headquarters very much included option appraisal techniques, etc. So we've gained quite a lot from that work that we can take into the rest of our organisation in applying techniques that have been useful throughout the headquarters process. And there's also information that we've gained again in the process around some of our estate in the areas that we looked at that again we'll be able to make further use of. So it's not all been wasted.
In terms of the new build, had you got as far as actually commissioning architects' drawings and planning applications and things?
We commissioned the kind of first stage of design, which would be appropriate in order to get a costing for it, but we hadn't gone further than that.
Okay, if we could have the cost, I'd appreciate that. Thank you.
Sure.
Well, thank you very much. That concludes the questions. I thank you very much for your attendance, and I'll suspend for 2 or 3 minutes. Thanks for meeting sake. Right, thank you very much. I move on to our last session, and I call Catherine. Call, you think I was in court? Yeah, you'd be happy with that. And I welcome Catherine Dyer. Didn't say I call you, but just what was Kelvin Catherine Dyer, Crown Agent, Chief Executive, Crown Office and Procurator, Fiscal Service. And I thank you again for your written submission. And again, I'll go straight to questions, please. Who wants to come in first? Margaret.
Good morning. It's still morning, Ms. Dyer. I wonder if I could refer to the late submission we had from the FDA, which raises some concerning issues about performance indicators in the High Court, where 40% of the cases, approximately 240 cases, are being indicted less than 4 weeks, and the vast majority of these in less than 4 weeks, the day before or on the day. And the Sheriff Court, only 71% are meeting the target of 4 weeks before indictment taking place. And our point, I think, is together with the National Initial Case Prosecuting Unit and the pressure it's under, is that there are huge staff shortages and the Fiscal Service is clearly under quite a bit of pressure. Overtime's available, but there's life-work balances.
Well, certainly life-work balance is something that we're very aware of for our staff. I think in the basis of both these things, the indicators she's talking about are internal ones that we use. I think the committee will have seen the report from the Inspectorate of Prosecution in Scotland on the very tight time bars that we have in custody cases and in what we call solemn cases, ones that have to appear before a sheriff and jury or High Court. That report indicated that we should move to a performance indicator of indicting within 7 days of the target. We've met 100% of the cases being indicted. It's always a very pressurised area of work. As I say, it's the tightest timescales, I think, in the Western world for indicting custodies. A lot of the High Court cases now, as you'll know from the rest of the papers, are dealing with sexual cases where people are not being granted bail or unfortunately, homicides as well. And so the staff do have to work to very tight timescales. I don't accept that what the figures that she's quoting mean that we're not dealing with our work properly. We deal with it internally to make sure that we make the statutory targets, and that's been happening in 100% of the cases. With regard to the initial case processing, that's where summary case reports come in from the police, and the decision is made whether there should be prosecution action or not. And that is a new unit that we were setting up, centralising that to try and take the pressure off staff in the local offices, who sometimes were finding that they had to go between making a decision on cases, what we call case marking, but if they were going to court, that obviously put pressure on them. So what we did this year was centralise that. It's now in two locations, and we've had an interim sort of transition into that. So yes, we have used overtime. We had to take one of our essential people out of that for another serious matter where he was the best fit. And it's much like listening to what my colleague Alasdair was saying in terms of fire and rescue. I think it's judicious use of overtime. We've recruited additional permanent staff this year. That's the first time that we've been able to do that for quite a significant time. So I absolutely accept that it's not everything rosy in the garden. These are very difficult times within which to manage all of this. But I have to say that the staff in the Fiscal Service are dealing very well with it.
Yeah. Can I just check? Because this was a late submission that we had. You have seen this.
I got it at 12:24 last night. I wasn't awake at that point, so I got it first thing this morning.
So yeah, you've got your copy with you?
Yes.
You have. It's just fine, thanks. Yeah.
I got it this morning as well. So
we just got them this morning as well. So.
I think the point to be made is that I appreciate some additional staff coming in, but I don't think it isn't sustainable at this level. And I wonder, for example, trainees are trained up in the first Fiscal Service every year, but not retained.
No, that's not correct. A lot of the people that we have, what we've been trying to do within the constraints to be ready for whatever's coming in each year as we try and sort of work out our budget, because I think that's the difficulty for most of us in the public sector, is trying to anticipate that we don't know what's going to happen till sort of very late on in the last financial year for the next financial year. It doesn't allow you to plan very much. So what we've been doing is having temporary staff in terms of legal staff till we were sure that we were going to be able to afford going forward to make them permanent. Now, a lot of these people, we have to do open and fair recruitment for that. People would expect that. A vast number of them are people that were trainees with us. And throughout this period, despite the financial constraints, we have not sort of faltered in terms of taking on trainees, because we think that it's very important for the whole of the, really the legal profession in Scotland, that as a big public sector employer, we continue to have trainee solicitors, and not just that, but also modern apprentices. We've had, over the past couple of years, over 60, and we were able to take on most of them into permanent positions again this year. And we've got another 32, I think it is, of the modern apprentices starting this year. So it's not as it was in the heyday when public spending meant that you could always anticipate that the next year was going to be more, and so you could just immediately do a recruitment round that fitted in with your trainees finishing, and say more or less, unless they flunked completely at the interview, they were probably going to get a permanent post. That's long gone. But what we have done is made sure that people who are well-versed in what we require for prosecution get the opportunity to apply for open, fair and open competition, fixed term contracts, and then when we're able to say that we know that we've got money to make them permanent, that's what we do.
So while it's welcome that the fixed term contracts are becoming fewer and these are now permanent staff, which helps take away from the necessity for overtime, then I still don't really accept, if you train someone up, it seems to me ludicrous that you then let them go. Prosecutors don't grow in trees.
No.
They have a very specialist
solicitors
knowledge.
Yes.
And therefore, it seems to me a little bit of a waste of money not to, to keep them on, given there are still, even
well,
with the
that's
fixed
what I'm trying
contracts
to say. With
and with the other additional staff there, still being let go and then maybe coming in later at a later point?
Well, I think, you know, you want to speak to the legal profession as a whole, because everybody that trains up trainees, you know, they can't guarantee that they're going to give them a permanent job at the end of it. I think the Crown Office and the Fiscal Service is actually recognised as a very good trainer in Scotland. We've got our prosecution college. They get an excellent training. They're well fitted for court work anywhere, but obviously particularly prosecution, and we're very keen to have them if we can afford to have them. And in the past few years, I think our record of being able to retain trainees by giving them fixed term contracts and then moving quite a number of them onto permanent contract has really been very good for the profession and for Crown Office and the Fiscal Service. That's not at all to say that this has not been a difficult time to manage through for people and for staff.
If I could just get this in perspective finally then, convener. Last year when you came, then I quote, "I would not expect you to think I should ask for things when I do not have work to carry out with them." Mm-hmm. In other words, I got the impression that, yeah, there were some problems, but we're managing quite well.
I think I
detect a slight movement this year. There is at least an acknowledgement there is some pressure under resources and staffing. To what extent is that met by the increase and then offsetting that with the inflationary costs, which I estimated came up to about 3 million deficit shortfall?
No, I mean, obviously, I think we can all accept that all of us that have been coming to these committees over the years from 2010 onwards have been coming with decreasing pots of money as we go through. So I think the position is that it gets tougher all the time is the reality of it. In terms of, do we have enough money? Do we ask for money? I think I've made it clear, and I'm sort of just maybe take this opportunity to say, I see that the letter inviting me said this was an informal session with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. Crown Office and the Fiscal Service sit completely independently from that. It's the Lord Advocate who's the Minister for Crown Office and the Fiscal Service, and who negotiates directly with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, because the Prosecution Service has to be independent. Now, as a result of that, over the last few years, we have been able to go and ask in year when we've had extraordinary cases that we really didn't think we would be able to absorb. And we've also had the joint working and additional funding, which has been confirmed for this year again and is supposed to be for the next few years, to allow a work programme to make sure that the court delays are brought in summary courts. And so it is a case of that we do ask for money when we have the work to do it. Certainly, as I said, I think a previous time, there's no chief executive on earth is going to come and say they wouldn't want more money because they could do more things with it. So that's the position we're in. We're trying very hard to make sure that we keep up and improve the service delivery against very tightening budgets, and that's just the reality of it.
I've got John, then Elaine, then Roddy. John.
Thank you, convener. Thank you for your written evidence, Mr. Yeah. We've also got evidence from Michelle McLeod, HM Chief Inspector,
yes,
and Inspector of Prosecution, and there's some startling figures in there. If I could maybe just refer to one of them. 80% of cases of sexual crime, 80%, an increase of 80, beg your pardon, an
yes,
increase of 80% of cases of sexual crime being reported between 2010
yeah,
and 13. And also in your own evidence, you talk about the number of domestic abuse charges marked for court.
Yes.
And an increase of more than 50%. That's against an overall budget cut of 14% in, between 2010 and 2014. Now, on one level, it's very good news, and it's a confidence in the police and the prosecuting services that these historic cases of child abuse and are coming forward. But has anything had to drop off your agenda to deal with that?
No, I mean, what we've done with it, I think, again, members will be aware that there was a lot of legislation passed in sort of the early parts of the 2000s where there was summary justice reform and where that enabled the police and the Procurator Fiscal to deal with matters without having to bring them to court. So there's been a lot of movement of appropriate cases in that direction. Crime overall has been falling, so it's a mixture of things. So no, we haven't had to have anything drop off. What we have done is changed around what our staff are doing. And I think the reality of it is that nowadays, from when I joined in the early 1980s to now, it's a very different job. People are having to deal with the more serious end of casework. That's what we're dealing with, and that's what the courts are dealing with. And so it's a movement of resource by sort of dealing appropriately by fixed fiscal fines or other direct measures, or by the police dealing with a measure that they can deal with. The number of cases reported to us is going down, and what we're left with are these ones that, as we all agree, are the ones that need to be dealt with.
Well, I was going to ask about diversion from prosecution, but are you able to, I know this is a very challenging area, but are you able to predict ahead then, if there has been this growth in the last 3 or 4 years, presumably built on public confidence around the police and the prosecution, is there an anticipation that will continue?
I think the position that we're in, we've talked, we work very closely, although I'm sort of indicating obviously that we need the independence of the prosecution service. That's got to be a complete requirement in any sort of proper constitutional position. We work very closely with the police and the courts and all the other justice agencies, and we sit on the justice board, and that's very much what we try and do, is look forward. And I think a few years ago we sort of realised that there was going to be the increase. We worked with the court, and that's why we've got the additional work programme with the courts to try and make sure that that increase of cases going into court didn't cause too many delays for people in getting their case to trial, whether that's the accused or the victim or witness. But at the end of the day, we think it's probably a plateau. This is the new norm, is what we're talking about. Whether it will go up again, so much depends on, you know, what it is that causes public confidence. We're obviously going to have the inquiry into previous sexual abuse in institutions, and whether that will bring forward more people who we are currently now then able to sort of deal with the case is as yet to be seen. So as far as we can say, I think our predictions were that we were going to come to a plateau of a new norm. We're sort of there, and we'll just have to wait and see if there's anything else that crops up that makes it that people come forward in greater numbers to report any particular type of crime.
Is there a danger then with alternative prosecution, and we're hopefully moving to a situation where there's a presumption against short sentences, and there'll be implications connected with that, that the police discontinue reporting matters to you that they should be reporting to?
I don't think so. Again, we work very closely with them. We actually share the statistics that they have and can have a look at things. We can go in and ask about individual cases. I think there's a very good understanding. The Lord Advocate in Scotland is in a particular position which doesn't apply down south, where it's the Crown Prosecution Service or whatever, in that he instructs the police about what they have to do with certain types. That's enshrined in statute as well as what was in the common law. And so there's sort of a quality check always going on between ourselves. I mean, we quality check for our own staff when they're doing direct measures that they're appropriate. We sample, we have filters where we look and say, you know, that charge type doesn't look right for that kind of direct measure, and go in and look at the case, and the police do the same thing.
And help me here, what can the police do short of reporting to you? Are we talking about a system of formal warnings?
They can do formal warnings, and they can give fixed penalty notices that are police issue ones for certain types of crime. Again, if the committee is interested in that, quite happy to sort of provide the information of the type of crime. It's all aimed at the stuff where you think, well, actually, it could be dealt with out with a court. We want courts to be there where it's a sentence or, you know, that can be imposed by a court for that particular offender. It's got to be now that really we're saying we're hopefully using courts for what they're supposed to be used for, and not gumming them up with things that otherwise would be seen as administrative or minor, where a warning would do
And we are obviously discussing the budget and, and prediction that if there was a move this way, the police might come back and say we need more resources to do this with the, is there a danger of that approach that you therefore aren't getting people with formal convictions and that might have implications if they're applying later down the line? Or
it would never be for something that was significant enough. It stays on people's records if it's a warning or a direct measure for 2 years. And therefore, if the person offends again in 2 years, the police know that, we know that. If it's one that needs to go to court, we can show the court that that's the history of offending. This is something that I think we're acutely aware of from when this legislation came in to extend the powers of fiscal fines, really, you know, to pay up to £300 in a fiscal fine or to £5,000 compensation. But if it's serious enough, it really still has to go to court.
And finally, please, where does the money from a fiscal fine go?
I think it's into the consolidated fund. I'm not sure. It's certainly not to the fiscal service. And I know, talking about the impact, there are changes, and that's why we really need to discuss around the Justice Board table, because I know that there has been an impact on Scottish courts' revenue from the fact that when they absorbed what was the district courts into the JP courts and became responsible for that, they then didn't get some of the money that the district courts had got that went to councils. So you do have to be careful if you adjust one bit, you're not doing something bad to the other. But the fiscal service relies entirely on the grant of parliamentary budget. That's it. We have no other revenue source. We're not like, you know, the courts have got fees that they can charge. They've got areas where, obviously, they can ask people to fill out forms and you have to pay a fee. We don't have that. The police obviously can gain money from different sources and for events, funding, etc. The fiscal service relies entirely on what the grant of budget by Parliament is.
Okay, many thanks.
Thank you.
I think it would also, would it not look unseemly if fiscal fines went straight back the fiscal service as you had a little revenue source?
Yes, and I think, you know, we talk about you don't want to be sort of incentivising, criminalising people or whatever, which it might be characterised as.
No, I know, but I thought it was to make it plain that that would not be a good idea. Elaine.
Thank you, convener. Thank you. Both your submission and the submission, the late submission from PFS, describe a number of additional pressures, including the prioritisation of domestic abuse and stalking cases, housebreaking cases, abuse in institutions, and the requirements of the Victims and Witnesses Act. Given that these pressures are increasing, and there's not much expectation that your budget will also be increasing, what efficiency savings have you been considering?
We've been doing a lot of work again. I think we anticipated from 2008 on that this was likely to be the position, that it would be an ever-tightening amount of public sector money. We've done a lot in COPFS. I think we're one of the, I'd have to say, world-leading in terms of the digital strategy that we've got, in terms of the fact that the system in Scotland allows for electronic transfer from the police to ourselves, that we can then electronically transfer the work around COPFS. So listening again to what Mr Hay was saying in terms of needing to have the right people in the right place, we've solved some of that to some extent by being able to move work electronically, which is why when we've got the initial case processing set up that we're talking about, it's a new one just now, we're saying that we can move work that would traditionally have had to be done in that individual office to a centralised place where people are doing nothing but that and are getting very quick and efficient at doing it. So that's the kind of efficiency that we've been looking for. A lot of savings, obviously we've moved out of some buildings. We have to have a presence every single place that there's a court, so that's where the fiscal's offices are. We've done a lot in terms of working with, we have a shared common service with the Scottish Court Service in terms of our facilities management, which has been very substantial, and I think it's about £250,000 a year that we've saved on that while improving buildings. And we look for things, for instance, we've got a building in Glasgow that at the moment is getting solar panels, etc., and the windows renewed, in terms of that we've got a business case for that, which shows that it'll be a substantial saving in terms of heat going out of the building. So anything and everything is really what we're sort of looking at.
Mm-hmm. You do also say in your written submission that your room for manoeuvre is becoming much more limited.
Yes.
I wondered if you could expand on that a bit.
Well, I think, you know, as I was saying to Ms Mitchell, there's no way on earth that you can say as it gets tighter, and you know, you've got to be able to say there'll become a point where really you've not got much room for manoeuvre. We've had an awful lot of legislation, all of which is very welcome in terms of taking things forward for victims and witnesses. we obviously have to constantly be looking then at where we're moving resource about and what we need. We've got a workforce planning group that's looking, trying to sort of anticipate, you know, the questions as what it's going to look like within 5-10 years to make sure that we've got the right people, because prosecutors don't grow in trees. We've got a lot of other things where we think we've done, you know, what people would expect in terms of cold case and double jeopardy, where it's cases, if it's a homicide, it doesn't matter how old it is. If we get sufficient evidence, we're looking for evidence for that with the police to get closure for families. So it's tight. It's a very crowded landscape with a lot of things. I don't think anybody would want us to give up. We have no plans to give up anything at the moment, but we're working very hard to make sure that that's not what the reality is.
I'm not trying to suggest you should give up doing anything, but what happens when you run out of room to manoeuvre? What happens then?
Well, that's going to then be a situation where we would be saying we can't go ahead doing this. We need to sort of discuss if there's something further that we can get, which we've done, of course, in terms of, as I say, there's a number of sort of big sensitive cases, and cases like the Lockerbie case keep taking resources as a movable feast. You never really necessarily know from one year to the next what the developments are going to be, and that's the kind of situation where we would come back and say, you know, we need more money for this, and that's been given in years past.
You get that from the Justice Board, you go to the Justice Board.
No, that's the Lord Advocate goes to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance.
Just thinking, we've put forward a lot, some of the legislation you've mentioned, victims and witnesses, put additional pressures on, and even the current bill we're doing on Domestic Abuse mm-hmm. Act and sex offenders and so on the internet, that's going to add again, surely, to, you know, are the government's financial predictions realistic from your experience about the workload that then comes to yourselves?
Well, we have the opportunity, obviously, to put in financial memoranda where we try and estimate what it is. In some years, I think there's an expectation has been that you would absorb that, and in some years we have absorbed it. In other years, we've been able to say, like, we can't actually absorb this. It's, you know, we're not going to be able to sort of take this on without having additional funding. I think the trick with it all is to sort of look and see. It's quite right that the public would expect that you spend every pound as well as you can, and that was interesting listening to the last presentation in terms of that. What we try and do is say we have to prioritise things, we have to move around, we have to look at systems of being more efficient, which is why our initial case processing is a good example of that, of saying we've got fewer people working on it, but they're actually doing nothing else. They're very targeted, they're quicker. They've got special screens that, you know, would cost us a fortune if we were doing that, and it wouldn't be necessary throughout the country, but we can do it in these two specific places. We're looking very much, we've got a Shaping the Future programme where we're looking at the specialisation route, because that's where we've found that we've made savings and improved quality. It's been quite a good success story for us so far, and that's how we've managed to deal with quite a lot of the things that have come along. And I think in terms of what... If we can make it better for victims and witnesses, if we can make people feel confident to turn up at court and give evidence, that's one of the things, obviously, that really then would make the whole system work better. So these things we recognise as being helpful overall.
Yeah, I just think the trafficking bill, you know, all the stuff that we mm-hmm. put through really impacted mostly on police and yourself.
Yes.
But so far, so
well,
good.
Well, I think Well, so far so good in terms of, yes, we have managed this. I think the thing is, as we're sort of going forward again, it will very much depend, it's demand-led to some extent, mm-hmm. of what comes in through the door. And I suppose some of the things we've dealt with but maybe didn't put the labels on before, so that's maybe not too much of an increase in terms of work, but other things definitely are. If we're trying to improve the service that we give to victims and witnesses, then we really need to get better at what we're doing, and that does take resource.
Roderick.
Thank you, Convener. Most of my questions have been answered, but I'd just perhaps pose one question in relation to the High Court cases, and perhaps I ought to refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates. There's a 9% decrease in the last year. Has that, we're kind of halfway through this year, has that trend continued, or what's happening in the High Court now?
What's happening in the High Court is that more cases are going to trial now. Some of this is because of the nature of the offending. At the moment, we think it's over 70% of the cases that are going into the High Court are sexual offending cases. Very, very different from my youth, where, you know, at most it was 25%. It's now really, I think, got to the point where that is the business of the High Court, apart from homicides. That is a challenge both for the police ourselves and for Scottish Court Service and the judiciary in terms of how do you deal with this. People do not tend to plead as readily to sexual abuse cases as they do to other things. And that's just one of the things about testing the witnesses. I think it's part of the dynamic of this. Some of us are not wanting to sort of face up to it. At the moment, I certainly know that there is pressure on the High Court. There's no doubt about that in terms of the number of cases. We have the highest ever number, I think, that we've had in history of advocate deputies, Crown Counsel in Crown Office and the Fiscal Service. So it's, you know, we're well versed in terms of what we need for that. I think it's just the time that cases are taking to go through court because there are so many of them that are actually going to trial.
So that 9% decrease is not going to be replicated in this year, in your view?
I don't think so.
No.
But again, that's something that Scottish courts and ourselves meet regularly with, and I'll check that when I go back and come back to you if it's a different answer.
Thank you.
Alison.
Has the federated system that you set up bedded in, and has it made you some savings?
It has. Certainly, I think you'll see our purpose in all of this is to protect the front line of things, because that's what matters to the people of Scotland. I think you'll see in the statistics we gave in terms of the reduction that we've made in the senior civil service posts. We've put in further posts at a more local management grade. We think we lost a bit, and we've been listening obviously to both our staff and our partners in terms of the local effect. That happened, I think, as a result of ourselves going ahead, anticipating the Police Scotland move, then the Police Scotland move, and everybody now is trying to do a rebalancing act. So that's part of our Shaping the Future. What we've got is a local court project where it's really trying to sort of indicate that is a very important part. I mean, that's what people would identify the fiscal service with, and we really need to make clear, you know, who's carrying out that role and where they're carrying it out, and move as much as we can to be dealt with away from that and leave these offices that's what they're delivering. They're delivering local summary courts and they're delivering in local sheriff and jury courts. We've already got a system where the High Court is a national one. And what we're looking at in the Shaping the Future is to move to say we keep the federations, but we specialise more in the management of the functions. So there'll be more emphasis on local court delivery as an absolute management priority.
Okay, thank you.
That's fine. Thank you very much. That concludes the evidence session. Thank you indeed. And any of the additional evidence that you sought to give us would be very useful if you send it in writing.
Okay, thank you.
We'll clarify if necessary through the clerks who took notes, I think, at the time of what we're seeking. Thank you very much. We now move into private session.